Welcome back to Dyson Sphere Program. My name is Niklas, and what we have here is a bus, a main bus in Dyson Sphere Program. I see a lot of people claiming falsely that a bus has no place in Dyson Sphere Program, but I am here to tell you that they are wrong, very, very wrong. I've been bit there myself. I've been disliking a bus particularly because they were so easy to just get the ins and outs with planetary logistics and interstellar logistics. But it actually has a merit because it's super easy to build anything you want, and that's exactly what we do. We build every single building in the game is built here on this bus, and it works wonders. And what is particularly easy about it is how easy it is to set up, how easy it is to get started, and how easy it is to hook up new things to the bus. And you know, the fact that it looks so goddamn awesome is also a nice little thing. So let's start with the beginning on how to get it started. And we're now going back to the very early game, and this is about an hour or 2 hours, depending on your speed, into the game. And what I built is always like this is my first structure that I built. I built it from blueprints that you have available. Not particularly part of this design, but I think it's good to have it. It's part of the new early hub, older build, and it's blueprint number 1, 2, and 3 that I put in here. Then I basically just have some of the basic items available. And what I then need to do is we first need to figure out where to place it. So here's an important part, and they might be finding that to be a little bit annoying, but it's very important. This is the equator. You need to build it at least 4 tiles away from the equator. So that is the closest you're allowed to place to the equator. The reason is, if you want to use the equator for something like solar panels or something like that, you also need to have room for later on to put an interstellar logistics station. So this is the closest. You can make it 5 tiles away, fine. If you make it too far, then they might actually bump into the fault line further to the north, which is a problem as well. But this is basically where you want to design it from. So we go to our blueprints, and these blueprints are of course available in the description below. So that is something. And we get a starter module like this, and I can then build it. As I said, I want to put the assembler on this line. I can then build it depending on how close you want it. You can build it like this. What it does is it makes sort of the template for the bus and gets some of the items in here, and it gets the first 2 of these. I also have a starter hub, starter storage, where you then, instead of having the storage here, you can get the storage as part of the bus as well. This will also be helpful later on if you want to use fidget spinners to get stuff in here. The key point about this bus compared to what you might have seen other people do is that I have the bus on level 2. Not level 1, or not ground level. The reason is that it allows me to make it super incredibly easy to drag things off the bus. So what we're going to do now is we're just going to make this, build this, and then we'll see how it, what it looks like. I will actually stamp down one more so that we have a little bit more to work with. I will also show you that what you can do if you really feel so inclined, they overlap exactly. And you can then hold it down and then drag the blueprint, tap multiple times to get the displacement, and then tap it back to have the news. Then you can stamp down multiple at the same time. Though I don't think that's what you want to do in this early game. So now we have meticulously built everything, and we can now hook it up. We built the hook up the iron, the stone, the greens, the coils, the glass, and the copper. Those are the things that we are producing. I've also built a little branch off the iron line for us to build gears. That is kind of needed. And then we see now that things will flow on this bus, and what we can actually do is we can disconnect the other ones because we don't want to have double storage for any of these. That's just something I have built previously. Here we go, and that will just delete all the old storage, and I will move the storage locations over to this location where it actually belongs. So how does this bus work? Let's have a look. The first thing you want to do is the most important thing, and that is belts. Then you want to make sorters, and this order is basically up to you yourself, but you can... I'm going to build it like this because I think that's the stuff you want the first. And then basically this is the meticulous part of all of the stuff. You just... there's just nothing to it. You figure out what you need. You need iron and gears. Then you take a belt here and you drag it in, and you take the next one and drag it in. And put it in here, put it in here. It's that damn simple. And then you figure out how much you want. I always do this, but that's just maybe double insurance, but that just works. It is really, really simple. And I've seen a lot of, seen some other creators do really weird stuff with lots of belts and splitters and ups and downs and rounds and all that stuff. Nah, you don't need it. Just do like this. There we go. And assemblers, what do you need? You need the first. And you need the green circuit. And you need that one. So the real strength of this is how easy it is to build. It's, that's really the biggest strength here, is that it is incredibly easy to build this. And therefore, it's something that will just save you a lot of time. You realize that you want one more thing on the bus, and it's not a pain in the ass. It's simply just, like this. And that's it. Now we have all these things on the bus, and we will not need to worry about them. I can then go back to stamping more on the bus here, if I want to add more. And then we'll just propagate. Probably want to do splitters a little bit earlier than you might want normally, because, you know, splitters are used quite a lot for this build. There are some disadvantages, and maybe you're already typing away angry comments about the number of belts used. Yeah, sure, there's a lot of belts used. You're doing this not to save on belts. That's the weirdest thing to save on. Second, you have a lot of belt storage, like some valuable things like early on processors seem really valuable. And you end up spending a lot of stuff just on the bus. Yeah, that's true. But again, I don't really feel that is an issue, because it's a one-time thing. You spend the money once, and then that's it. It's spent. It's not a continuous drain. It is just you now have 100 on the bus that's sitting there. But the production capacity versus the consumption capacity, that's going to be the same. It's just that maybe you could have built 3 more if you hadn't put them on a bus. But no matter what you do, when you later on get into planetary logistics or the fidget spinners, and then, you know, you're going to have buffers here and there. And we'll just show for good measure how easy this one is. That one, and that one. So this is the core of this one. It is built for your convenience, so it looks, it's super easy to build, and it is also extremely easy to modify and add more stuff. And of course, you know, it looks really aesthetic, and then you can just keep expanding as you need more stuff. You just feed them in from the side here, and then they go on the bus as you progress. Let's look a bit into the future and see how it expands, and how it some special cases as well. As you can see, we're now a little bit later in the game. We have expanded the bus. It has a certain number of extra things. This is basically all I want. I think I actually want the reinforced thrusters in the very late game also added to the bus. But nothing really aside from this. This is all the items you you want. And what I've done as well is I have removed the storage up front with the PLSs that are now getting things inbound. And that's how we get things in. Okay, that's most of the cases, that's something, that's how we get stuff in. But we do get things inbound here, and that is goes on the bus. I have monitors here to trigger if nothing is flowing on the bus for 30 seconds, then it will throw a warning, so I can see that as well. What I've also done is I've set up here some fidget spinners for everything, so that means I can now use my logistics to request anything I want as soon as I land on the planet. Then I can get stuff in here. So that's really convenient how to integrate this, the storage, into fidget spinners. Also remember that you can always grab stuff from anywhere on the map through the fidget spinner thing. So if you have something built, you can grab it from here. So that's also nice. That's another advantage of this, that anywhere on the planet, even though you don't, the fidget spinners can't reach you because they have mediocre range in the beginning, then they will still be able to, you can still grab the stuff if you're working on some designs some on another part of the planet. There are a few special cases that I want to emphasize here, and this is one of them. The microcrystalline component is an annoying thing. It's part of the processor, but it's used for two buildings and only two buildings. That is here, the proliferator, and it is also here for the base battlefield assembly base, the BAP. And since it's only used for these two items, I prefer to build it here and then just have it sort of push into the nearby ones and be done with it. There are a few other cases. Here is the case of the prototype, goes into precision drones. The prototype can also go into the attack drone. So it, maybe you want to build, if you want both precision drones and attack drones, then you can sort of leave it on both sides available. Or if you only wanted to replace it, then when you have the attack drones, then you just replace these and put attack drones in instead. You can also see here, if there's something else that is requested, but not not valuable enough to put on the bus, such as I'm not going to put power poles on the bus, then you request it in here with another fidget spinner. And because of the distance on the bus, it should be able to, even with the first upgrades, to actually bring things in. Oddly enough, something like titanium is only used for a single item. You'd think that something like titanium is used for a lot, but titanium alloy is used for a lot, but not actually raw titanium. It's only used for the PLS. The PLS should be having the next one for the ILS, that is the planetary logistics system station, and the interstellar logistics station, and then the gas extractor next one. So those three should be next to each other. What you can do is then make, after the gas extractor, make one for the reinforced thrusters, but I actually prefer to put reinforced thrusters on the bus because they're going to be used for corvettes and destroyers in a very late game. So that's another thing you can see here as well. We have these being requested in, so you will request stuff that is not used. My rule is that if an item is used for three things, then it goes on the bus. If it's used for less than three things, then it's just going to be requested in. And each of these can support four items, five items, but not both of them cannot support five items. But if you have four items, there are very few buildings that require five items. But if you have something that requires five items, like the exchangers, for example, then don't build it next to something else that also needs five items unless they share one of them. And now we're in the final stages of this. What I've also added is proliferation. I would recommend adding proliferation a lot earlier. I didn't do it, and I think that's a very valid thing. There's a rule here when it comes to buildings that if all the ingredients are intermediate products, then you can get extra products. If one of the ingredients is another building, then you cannot get proliferation. Let me show a good example of that. That one, for example. Here you can get the production speed up or energy consumption, but you can't get it because one of the ingredients is a building. So you can't get a building proliferated and get that into another thing. That's just a hard rule. So what you can do is if the bus is proliferated, then anything that goes in here will be proliferated. The exceptions is that the stuff that can't be proliferated, like the next tier, which will get some assembly machines that are not proliferated, but that doesn't matter because you can't get extra products here. This is how I do sort of the temporary or the intermediate parts for belts, the different tiers, sorters different tiers, and assemblers different tiers. It's a little bit crowded, it's a little bit too crowded, but there's an option for that. Now we come to the part that I mentioned in the beginning, that the reason why you want to build it at exactly four squares away from the equator. Here's the equator with the solar power line. 1, 2, 3, 4, that's the part. And if you do that, you can build an interstellar logistics station right here, which can be set up. And this is also why I make a little bit more room between them, because that means that this is the minimum distance you can put ILSs next to each other. And that fits perfectly with five of these going into one and the next five going into the next. And that's the minimum distance between them. So yeah, not exactly a coincidence. If you build it anywhere else on the planet, if you build it the other way around, then the squares up here will be too small and the ILS will not be able to place in this pattern, and you just have to start hacking away at stuff. Each of these are going to set up to 100, and the reason why it's 100, there are a few exceptions, is because I want to set minimum load of vessels to 10%, so that when I'm sitting on another planet and requesting, let's say, mining machines in, I want to get the minimum amount of mining machines that I can, 100 mining machines, that's probably useful. But if I put 1,000 in here, they will be bringing 1,000, even if I only request 100, because they'll try to fill up the ship. They really want to do that. So stuff like this, I have smelters I've set up to 500 because I don't mind getting 500. And if I feel so inclined and want to request wind turbine, then give me 200 at a time. But most of the things, I don't want to request multiples, many hundreds of those at a time. But that's basically how it works. I've also done on the very first one, I'm also requesting warpers when you get there. And then there is exactly room for a line of warpers that feed from the first one into all the other ones, so that you are, let's get that red line away, so that all of them will also be fed by warpers by sort of a little single belt here, so they don't all have to request it. But as you can see, everything here is just set up to 100 each. Well, that's a little bit more, but there's a reason for that. And then everything is just being built here, and it just works. The disadvantage, if you want to say that, is that of course you're going to be having a lot of quantum chips, fully proliferated quantum chips, just lying around here. But that's a one-time investment. Once you have it, it's done. Now what you can do over here, in the beginning. This one, as I guess, a little bit too crowded. And when you're ready to switch only up to using the highest tier, then I have another blueprint for you. Isn't that lovely? I have always had blueprints. This is saved because it's an existing, it's an older blueprint, but it checks out. Make everything hub, and it's called the logistics hub. Just stamp that down, and then you have a final production of all of the ingredients you want. You might even want to get the even better magical recomposing assemblers if you have those later on. Then you can build those and upgrade them to go even faster. But this one is requesting all the inputs and requesting all the inputs, and then over here it's sending all the outputs and one input that was necessary, sharing that with the world, and also having warpers, of course, so that this can warp anywhere. And this part here replaces the little bit of overcrowdedness, and then you can remove that as you want. So that is basically the end of the bus. This is where it sort of ends. And with this one available, you can build anything you want in the game. Any building is on the bus, and you can request it from anywhere in the galaxy. And you can also, when you land on the home planet, you will just fill it up with thanks to the fidget spinners. And that's it. There are warnings, there are buffers, there are everything you want. So I think there's a really good argument for why a bus is absolutely amazing to have in Dyson Sphere Program. It is so easy to set up, it's so easy to expand. I have also made this blueprint here available for you, so that if you want like the complete one, then that's here. It's kind of in the mid game, but that is basically setting that one up if you're kind of in doubt on what to put on the bus. So that's it. So you have all the blueprints. I hope this was useful, inspiring, motivating. Maybe you want to say, oh, I actually want to make a bus like this, so that everything is built in one place and don't have to sort of hack it away. I've had other iterations and I was never really happy with. They work, but they were not super good. They were a little bit too hacked with all the PLSs and ILSs getting stuff inbound. This is super simple and it is working. So hope you enjoyed it. Thank you very much for watching. If you liked it, hit the like button. Leave a comment below if there's some additions, changes, improvements, questions, that kind of thing. Of course, come on by on Twitch. And if you want to get save games, you can get all the save games that I have as by pledging on Patreon. So thank you very much to everyone supporting. Until next time, take care and stay effective.